crying baby that you've got to feed and look after. And also, yeah, you, about half your salary or just under half is going to have to go to the government for tax. No, why? But it's my, I work, Dad, why do I give them? No, no, you live in their country, and so you got to pay for the water and the zesta and stuff. And even if you don't get it, you've still got to pay for it. No, Dad, this doesn't sound like much fun. How long am I going to be here for? Well, it depends, my boy. Life is really fragile. At any moment, you can die. Some will last for 20 years, 30 years, 40 years. It all just depends. Okay? And then when I die, then what, Dad? My boy, we don't really like to talk about this, but when you die, because you're born into this fallen world, you end up going to hell, where there is weeping and there's gnashing of teeth for eternity. Dad, I don't want this birth. Surely there's another birth with a little bit more hope and more joy and a better destination. Well, yes, there actually is, my boy. Well, can I have that one? Can I redo my birth? I want that one. How do I get that birth? And friends, that is exactly what I want us to be talking about this morning. I want to tell you about this new birth. And I want to look at how it's available to all of us, but how do we get this birth? Because if we're honest with ourselves, this world we live in is fallen and we've been born into a pretty awful world where there's pain and sorrow. But thankfully, there's another birth with slightly more joy and with a greater hope and a beautiful final destination. So let's talk about this new birth this morning. And so the title of my message this morning is, Can I Redo My Birth? Can I redo my birth? I don't want this birth I've been born into and into this world. Can I redo my birth?
Microphone.
Friends, we're in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23 to 25. Can I redo my birth? 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23 to 25. And just as that little baby boy asked his dad some questions about this world he has born into, I want to answer four questions, or I want us to look at four questions about this new birth. The four questions are, is this new birth really better? How is it possible to receive this new birth? Why is this the only way to receive the new birth? How do I get born again? And it's these four questions that will give us the 4 points, the structure that we're going to follow this morning. So if you're taking notes, you don't have to rush through these questions quickly. I'll bring them up as we go through. But the first question is this new birth really better? I'm going to ask you to engage with me a little bit. I want you to put your hand up if you know any of the following to be true or to exist in this world that we live in. Poverty. Wars, theft, prostitution, child trafficking, slavery, racism, physical abuse, substance abuse, sexual abuse. This hands up. We're not sure that there's anything in that world. 2 hands up and with confidence if you think this world is evil. Friends, we live in an evil world because man has chosen sin. We went against the plans of God, the Creator, and now we face the consequences by living in a world under the control of the evil one. And this is the world we're born into, the fallen, sinful world. But what about the new birth? Is it any better? Well, if we open our Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 23, we're told, he says, for you have been born again. And so, okay, well, there's this thought that there is another birth. There's a born again. There's something there. And if we look back at verse 3 of 1 Peter chapter 1, it says, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth." So there is a new birth, and we can be born again. But is this new birth really better? And in verses 3 through to 9 of 1 Peter, Peter kind of refers to all these various descriptions or these things that are true of this new birth. And I'm going to read verses 3 through to 9. And again, I'm going to ask for your engagement. As I'm reading, if you hear anything that says, "Oh, that's good, that sounds better," I want you to just clap your hands. Okay? I'm going to read from verse 3 to 9. If you hear anything that is good, clap your hands. Just once. We don't need a long round of applause. "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven." This is the most dismal congregation I've ever heard. I guess heaven's not that exciting, maybe. Verse 5, "who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In all this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to have suffered grief and all kinds of trials." That's a bold clap. "These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls." Amen. Does it sound better? You know what's interesting? God is considered gold. Is considered the most valuable thing in your physical birth. And yet we're told the most valuable thing in the physical birth is not even matchable to the value of what we receive in this new birth. And that's because the new birth is far better than our physical birth. And friends, it's an obvious yes, our spiritual birth, the new birth, is way better. So we get to the second question. Well, okay, it's better, but how is it possible to receive this new birth? How is it made possible for you and me to receive this new birth? Well, Peter makes it really simple to answer this question, and we see three reasons. If you look back at 1 Peter chapter 3, he says, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us." That's the first reason. God has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's the second reason it's possible. Because God gives and Jesus Christ was raised from the dead. There's two reasons. But what about us? How does that become true for us? How do we know that to be true? If we go back to verse 23, it says, "You've been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and enduring word of God." It's through the word of God, through the word of the Lord, that we can be born again. That's how it's possible. Through God's word. But why the word of God? Why is it that the word of God is what enables us to receive this new birth? And so we get to the third question. Why is this the only way, God's word, to receive new birth? What does 1 Peter 1, 23 tell us about the word of God? It says you've been born again. And this is what it tells us about the word of God. Not of perishable seed, but of imperishable. Through the living and enduring word of God. So friends, the first reason this word gives us new birth, and it's the reason it's possible, is because this word is living. The word is living. You see, the word of the Lord from beginning to end is all about Jesus. It points to Jesus Christ. And who is Jesus? He's the living God. And so because it's about the living God, the Word of God is living. Because it tells us about the living God. But it's also through Jesus Christ, the living God, that we receive life. The Word gives life. And so because it gives life, it's living. But Peter also tells us that it's the imperishable seed. And something that is imperishable means it cannot perish. It cannot die. It's living. And so for one to receive a living hope, remember this, we're born into a living hope. For us to receive something that is living, the seed that begins it needs to be living itself. And that seed is imperishable. The Word of God is living, and it gives life. Because the Word is an imperishable seed. What is the first step to producing apples? Apples, you need an apple seed. Not any other seed. You need an apple seed. You need a seed that is alive, and you plant that seed, and an apple tree grows, and then you bear fruit. And friends, that's the same for every single person who believes in Jesus Christ. It all began when they received the imperishable seed, when they heard about the truth of Jesus Christ, and they received that seed. And then from that seed, it grew and it grew, and now it produces fruit. Anyone in this room who believes in Jesus Christ, it started when you received or you heard about the truth of Jesus Christ. And you may have received that truth through your parents. You may have heard about that truth at school, at church, at youth group. You may have heard about the truth of Jesus Christ through a friend, through a stranger. However it was, your journey as a believer began when you received the truth, when you heard about Jesus Christ. So I want to encourage us. If you claim to follow Christ, if you call yourself a believer, then as you who has received a seed many years ago, be someone who is planting seeds. Someone planted a seed in your life when they told you about Jesus Christ, and we need to be seed planters telling other people about Jesus Christ. And we need to be watering those seeds so that God can grow those seeds into trees that they may produce fruit. We've got to be seed planters. Because that is how one receives new birth. Through hearing the truth of the Word of God. I want to turn to another common passage that tells us about the Word of God. It's Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. It says, for the Word of God is alive. It is living. The Word is alive. But it also tells us that the Word is active. And the second reason that the Word of God gives new birth is because it's active. Because the Word of God is active. Church family, the Word of God is active. It is powerful. It is not boring. It's not just a piece of history. It is active. It's transforming lives. It's more than just random words on paper. In Ezekiel chapter 37, some of us may know this account, this story. Ezekiel's in this valley and he's surrounded by dry bones. There's dry bones everywhere he looks, dead as dead could be. And God says to him, do you believe that we can bring life into these bones and breath into these bones? Ezekiel says, God, only you know. In my mind, it's impossible. They're dead. But God, only you know. And God says to him, prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you and you'll come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am Lord. Prophesy, tell them, share the word of the Lord. Speak the word of the Lord over these dry bones. And we're told that Ezekiel does exactly that. He prophesies over these bones. and these bones begin to rattle. Bone to bone starts to form. Tendons attach onto these bones. Flesh comes upon them and skin comes upon them, and you have these human form bodies now, what were bones and our human form bodies, but there is no breath. And God says, prophesy. Speak the word of the Lord into these bones, into these bodies now. And he does that. And they receive breath. And we're told that there was a vast army on their feet. What started off as a valley of dry bones is now an army of human beings walking and breathing. Why? Because they received the word of the Lord. Because the word of the Lord is active. It is powerful. And it does big things. And friends, that was the word of the Lord spoken. And this is the word of the Lord written. It is powerful and it is active. It is no different to the word of the Lord that was spoken. See, something that is active causes growth, causes improvement in one's life. If you're active in the gym, your physical health improves. If you're active in the garden, you remove the weeds and you improve the look of the garden. If you're active in something, it causes growth and improvement. And when we are active in the Word, it causes growth in our lives. It causes spiritual improvement because the Word of God is active. It's transforming, and it's more than just words on paper. What is the most popular book in the 1800s? The Bible, okay, other than the Bible? In the 1850s? In the 1900s? In the 1950s? In the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, the 90s. It's in our time. It's in our existence now. We don't really know. Or if we do, we can't remember. Why? Because that's just a book. It's a random book. It's not powerful. It's not active. It's not living. But the Word of God has remained constant throughout history because it is living and it is active and it is powerful and it's more than just words on a book. Look at 1 Peter 1, verse 24. It says, for all people are like grass, and all their glory is like the flowers of the field. The grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of the Lord endures forever. In 1850, the best-selling book other than the Bible was Uncle Tom's Cabin. Anyone read Uncle Tom's Cabin? I haven't, and I didn't waste my time looking at a summary, but I presume it's about Uncle Tom. And Uncle Tom, who is like the grass and the glories of the book, are like the flowers of the field that wither and fall away. But friends, the word of the Lord that is about Jesus Christ endures forever, because Jesus Christ is true, he is alive, and he is active. And because he is that, the word of the Lord is too. And that's why the word of the Lord causes new birth, because it is active and it transforms our lives. The third thing about the word of the Lord and the reason that it gives new birth, this comes from Hebrews 4 verse 12 as well, and it's because it's sharp. Because the word of the Lord is sharp. Hebrews 4:12, we carry on and it says, for the word of God is alive and it is active, and it's sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrows. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. What does it mean that God's word is sharp? How is it that the word being sharp causes us new birth? It's simple. The word is sharp and it cuts us and it reveals who we truly are. How do you know you're a sinner? How do you know that you're in desperate need of a savior? How do you know that Jesus Christ is that savior? Because the Word of God has penetrated into your heart and it's revealed the truth to you. If it wasn't for the truth of the Word, if it wasn't for Jesus Christ, no man, woman, boy, or girl would know they're a sinner, would know they need a Savior. They would not know that Jesus Christ is that Savior. We would not know that we are separated from God because we would not have been convicted by the Word of God that is sharp. The simple fact that we believe is proof that the Word of the Lord is sharp and it pierces our hearts and our souls. And that is why it's the Word of the Lord that causes new birth, because it tells us we need new birth. We get to the most obvious and important question now. How do I get born again? How do I receive this new birth? That's how it's possible, but how do I get it? Look at 1 Peter 1, verse 25. But the word of the Lord endures forever. And this is the word that was preached to you. Peter, speaking to believers scattered in all these various places, says, this is the word that was preached to you. You heard it. The truth of the gospel, the love of Christ, the sacrifice of Christ was preached to you. You heard it and then you believed it. And that's how they were born again. Some of you are looking at me, and I'm hoping most of you by now, if not, you've been sleeping, and you're thinking, this idiot has a big stain on his shirt. I know I do. When I left home this morning, I looked in the mirror, oh man, some tomato sauce on my shirt, but I'm in a rush to the meeting. I'll sort it out later. Rachel looked at me, she says, your shirt's still got it. Yeah, I'll sort it out. I'm worshiping now, I'll go change my shirt just now, it's in my office. Well, here I am. An absolute fool. And it's too late now. I know the problem, I could have fixed it, I didn't. You see, that's how we respond to the Word of God. We hear it. We know the problem. I'll deal with Jesus later. I'll sort it out another time. I'll get the new birth later. And then it's too late. And you're like me, you look like an absolute fool in front of God. And it's too late. Friends, God's word in Romans 10 says, you believe with your heart that Jesus was raised from the dead, and if you confess with your mouth that he is Lord, you will be saved. If we want new birth, it's through the confession of faith that Jesus Christ is our Lord, believing that he rose from the dead. That's what we need to do for new birth. We've heard it. We've all heard the truth. Prayers that all of us have responded and we believe, and we're not standing like an idiot like me with my shirt stained and thinking, it's too late now. James calls those type of people hearers, not doers. And I plead and I beg with every single one of you, do not be a hearer, be a doer. We have heard the word. We know the truth. We need to respond and we need to act on that truth. And if you've received Jesus Christ and you've responded to him already, then as you receive the truths of the word, act upon them. Because this is exactly what you look like when you hear the word on a Sunday, or when you're challenged by God's word in the morning and you go out and you don't even remember what you learned and you don't act upon it. You look like a fool like I am with my shirt stained. Because I'll sort it out later. No. How do we receive this new birth into the this better life by believing in Jesus Christ, the one who the Word is all about. And friend, if that's you this morning and you don't have that relationship with God, if you haven't entered into this new birth, then I plead with you, look into that seriously today. Come and speak to me afterwards. You'd be a fool like me to go home without sorting out the problem if the problem's not already fixed in your life. Church, as I come to a close, I begin where I started. Can I redo my birth? Yes, we all can. We've been born into the sinful, fallen world, but that's not the end, because God has intervened. And through the word of the Lord, we know that Jesus Christ has made it available for every man, woman, boy, and girl to receive salvation. We know that it is possible to receive birth because Jesus Christ has been raised from the dead. It is possible to receive new birth because God wants to give it to us. It is possible to receive new birth because every single one of us have heard the word of the Lord. What remains is whether you are going to choose to believe it or not. So that's my question to you as I close. Are you going to follow him as your Lord? And are you going to believe in him for your salvation? And if you are already, then are you going to plant seeds and share the truth of Jesus Christ that others may too receive this salvation? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for your word that is living and active and sharp. And Lord, I pray that you remind us of the value of your word that gives us new birth. May we be people who dig into your word and who study it and who are active in it, Lord, that it may cause us to grow and to be transformed. Anyone here this morning or listening online who may not know you, who may not have received this new birth through their belief in you, that you continue to remind them of your great love. And that your word, Lord, the truth of your word that is sharp, that it penetrates their heart and convicts them of their sin and reminds them tells them that you are the God who loves them and who died on the cross for them. Friend, if that's you, I plead with you. Surrender your life to Jesus Christ this morning. To receive this new birth into a living hope that does not perish, spoil, or fade. Lord, I also pray that your Holy Spirit gives us great boldness to be men and women who plant seeds, who share the truths of the Word, who share the truths of Jesus Christ with all those who come into contact with us. May many people get to heaven because of faithful seed planters at BBC, I pray. Shape and mold us, Lord, into who you desire for us to be. I ask this all in your mighty name. Amen.
Please stand with